presence. Come on, do you feel it? Hallelujah. Let's sing it.
Good morning, Acts family, and welcome to our virtual Sunday service. We're so grateful you've joined us to lift God's name today, and we thank you for the continued support. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube and follow us on social media at Acts Santa Monica to stay up to date on all things happening. And if you would like to give to our church, you could do so by going online to actsantamonica.org and by clicking on the donating tab. And you can also give by mail and send it in the P.O. Box 7217 in Santa Monica, California. We look forward to receiving your gifts. This week's verse is James 1:12, which says, God blesses those who endure the testing and temptation. They will receive the crown of life that God promises to those who love him. Friends, everything we go through has a purpose. And as soon as you start to doubt or feel any fear, God has a special way of showing you just how strong you are. And remember, here at Acts, we love you and we're here for you. And we want to pray for you. So send in any prayer requests through our social media pages or through our website. Now let's get our hearts ready for Pastor Joe's word with some praise.
Thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The battle is already won. Every battle is won with lifted hands. When we fall on our knees, we make our stand. You have all power. Every other power must bow down. You have all power. Every other power is already defeated. Don't know what you see right now, but just remember, you already won. Oh, yes, you have. It's not to fight, so please stand still, 'cause I believe the enemy you see today, you won't.
Yeah, it's not your fight, so please stand still, 'cause I believe, I believe. I got winning on my life. I have. I got winning on my life. I got winning on my life. I don't know what you see right now. Just remember,
you've already won.
Well, welcome back, friends. I recently spoke with you about standing firm in difficult times. Today, I want to address a part of that. Because these difficult times that we live in our world today, can bring a lot of sorrow and disappointment over us, pain and suffering. But there has to be something that God intends for us to gain from the pain and the suffering. So what is it? And what better place to look than to look around the life of Jesus Christ, because he certainly suffered. I want to take you back to the cross today because I think that we can see some benefits that come out of Jesus' experience on the cross. Now, the psalmist wrote some words that are interesting that we're going to take up, but in the book of Hebrews in the New Testament. The psalmist wrote these words in Psalm 8, King David, as a matter of fact, penned them. Now, we know for a fact that there was some 1,000 years between King David's reign and Jesus Christ's birth on the earth. But yet we find these words in both places, the Old Testament first, and then later in the New Testament, which indicates to me that the writer of the book of Hebrews, where our text will come from, was very familiar with the Jewish scriptures, the Hebrew scriptures, the Old Testament. So it says here in Psalm 8, and this is not the preaching portion, this is just a background, the reference. He says in Psalm 8, and starting at verse 1, he says, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. And then drop down to verse 4, same chapter 8. What is man that you are mindful of him? And the Son of Man, that you visit him. For you have made him a little lower than the angels, and you have crowned him with glory and honor. You have made him to have dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet. Now, this expression, as I mentioned to you, was written way, way before Christ came to the earth. But yet we find the same expression in the portion that I'll preach from today out of Hebrews, starting in chapter 2 with verse 5. Now, verses 5 through 10, I want to read into your hearing. I'm going to only preach verses 8 through 10, however. Here it says, For he has not put the world to come, of which we speak, in subjection to angels. But one testified in a certain place, saying, What is man that you are mindful of him, or the Son of Man that you take care of him? You have made him a little lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor, and set him above the works of your hands. You have put all things in subjection under his feet. Now the preaching portion, he says, For in that he put all in subjection under him. He left nothing that is not put under him. But now we do not yet see all things put under him. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone. For it was fitting for him, for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. So what the text is saying to us, essentially, is that Jesus has brought a lot of people to glory through his death on the cross. We could affirm that. We know some. We have family members and friends that have gone on to be in heaven with the Lord, and they knew the Lord before they left earth. So they're certainly with him now. Many of us suffer through some things, some bad things in this world that we live in. We have disappointments, even in speaking of the death of loved ones who are now in heaven. That's a loss to humanity. And when we lose someone, we suffer. We call that grieving. But there's a lot of other suffering that goes on in this world today. And how do we manage it? What's its purpose? There are losses that occur in everyone's life sooner or later. What does it mean to us? How does it benefit us? What can we get from it? There are discouragements that happen in the world that we live in. We're so discouraged at times, so defeated. We feel beaten up sometimes. What does that mean? And how should we manage those kinds of experiences? It was Jesus in discussion with his disciples, and we get to read what he had to say to his disciples in Matthew 24, verses 3 through 6. The scripture says, he sat on the Mount of Olives. The disciples came to him privately, saying, tell us, when will these things be, and what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? And Jesus answered them, see that no one leads you astray, for many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and they will lead many astray. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you're not alarmed, for this must take place, but the end is not yet. That's pretty amazing that Jesus Christ said that to his disciples who were so concerned about him leaving. In fact, we have wars and rumors of wars going on right now. I can't remember a time in my lifetime on this earth. I was born in 1948. Well, there's always been a war or a rumor of a war or some terrorists attacking some place in the known world today. These things are always going on. The Lord says, don't marvel at that. The end is not yet. There's some suffering that must take place before the end comes. So what's the benefit of this suffering? Well, I have a suggestion that I would like to make to you. When I look at this book of Hebrews and I divide it up, I see several warnings that the Lord gives us. We're going to look at one of these today. The first of the warnings is right here in chapter 2, and it starts out with warning us against drifting from the things that we have heard. The Lord says, don't run from the things, don't deviate from the things that you've heard. Let me read that to you in chapter 2 of Hebrews, because I think it's important for us to get this framework. Here he says for us in chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, for this reason, we must pay closer attention to what we have heard so that we do not drift away from it. That's the first warning that he gives us. For if the word spoken through angels proved intolerable and every transgression and disobedience received a just penalty, how will we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? And he says, after it was at all the first spoken through the Lord, it was confirmed to us by those who heard him speak. So the Lord is speaking to us and he says, don't drift away from this word that I have spoken. And he goes on to explain that statement in verse 4 here. He says, God also testified with them both by signs and wonders and by various miracles, by gifts of the Holy Spirit, according to his own will. So he's saying, don't drift away. That's the first warning he gives us from what we have said. Therefore, we have this reference to the Psalms written 1,000 years before. Same word to us that, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all of the earth. The fact that he had brought the Lord himself down to us. So what is this suffering? What's the accomplishment? What's the benefit of the cross? What's the benefit of going through this suffering? It's simply this, my friend. Let me give you the answer before we get started. It is to build a righteous character in every Christian. That's the purpose of the suffering. That's the benefit of it. Because in the end of it all, when we leave earth, we go to be with the Lord. And we go with a testimony, as Jesus had a testimony going to the cross and being resurrected. He brought many with him to glory. Friends, we'll be with him also one day in glory. And we know now friends and relatives who are with the Lord in glory. And they only got there because he went to the cross, was buried in a borrowed tomb, and got up early that morning. He's alive today, seated at the right hand of his Father, interceding for us, still concerned about us, even after dying for us. So as we break this apart, if we don't allow our earthly sufferings to build a righteous character, then the sufferings will build a sinful character. You know, when you suffer, sometimes it's hard, it's difficult, it hurts. It hurts even more if we see someone we love suffer. That's even more hurtful. How many times have we asked the Lord, Lord, can you heal them? Can you not let that happen to our child? Can you do this? Can you do that? We're always begging God to do something. But then we see his hand doesn't move, not in our lifetime, not on this earth. But eventually we see that loved one again on the other side in glory with the Lord, in the bosom of our Heavenly Father. So there's a benefit to this suffering that we go through this gateway. The fact that suffering is necessary for building character is one of the clearest truths, both in life and also in the scriptures. We see them both. Jesus himself is the greatest example of this for us. Apart from suffering, he endured to pay the consequences of our sin. He knew suffering, suffering that helped produce something in him. It gave him a group of people that would fall in love with him, that would accept him as their savior, that would follow him. It gave sinners a way out of this world and into his presence on the other side. So we too must suffer some in order to get in. C.S. Lewis kind of said it this way, and I think it's a very appropriate statement that's very well known. He said, God whispers to us in our pleasures. He speaks in our conscience, but he shouts in our pain. When you're going through something, the Lord knows. He knows everything there is to know about us. What are we allowing our earthly sufferings to create in us? A sinful character? Or a different kind of character, a righteous character? Do we act like Christ or do we act like Satan when we're going through a time of suffering? Let's look at this production of suffering. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 9, he says, but we do see him who is made a little lower than the angels, namely Jesus. He gives us his name. He tells us who he's talking about. He said, because of the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. He took it on himself. He suffered so you and I could live. The character of humility is being built through the suffering of Christ, him who was made a little lower, while lower than the angels, it says, carries two thoughts with it. Just that little simple statement. The first thought it carries is the lower state was temporary. He said it was for a little while. It was just temporary. Your suffering is temporary. It's for a little while. Oh, it seems like it's forever. It's been going on forever, it seems. But it's just a little while. And that's exactly what he's saying to us. It carries this great thought of it's not going to be forever. It's not going to be always. By the way, if we are saved, we are in this earthly house, this earthly state for a little while. Amazing, isn't it? Yeah. And then eternal life with the Lord will follow that. We'll be in glory with him, receiving honor. This lower state was humbling, is our second thought about it. Jesus in his humanity was lower than the angels. He was brought down. He came down to earth to live with us, to walk with us, to experience what you and I will experience on this earth. No one can tell him what that was like. The value of suffering produces a crown of both glory and honor, he says. So glory meaning he is already crowned, the unseen by us. He's still crowned today with glory and honor. And he's not there by himself. He has many with him that are worshiping him today. We're going to see him one day fully. We're going to understand that. We don't have that understanding today. But he has promised us that we will get it. You see, the ground for his exaltation is on account of his having suffered death. The only reason he gets to go to glory is because he suffered death on earth and was resurrected by his Father. And then brought to glory, restored to the glory that he had before he left the Father. We too will be resurrected one day. I kind of look at this in the meaning that because he's already crowned and we don't see him, Paul wrote something about that in Philippians chapter 2, verses 8 through 11. Paul says, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason also God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee will bow, of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father, God himself. Friends, everyone is going to confess who Jesus is, whether you know him now or not. You may not know him now, but those that do know him will certainly praise his name later, and those that die not knowing him will understand at that point that he is the Father of glory, that he is the resurrected Christ who came to die to give salvation to everyone in humankind. Eventually, we'll all know it. In crowning him with glory and honor, the honor of having noble powers and faculties of soul, excellent organs and parts of his body, whereby he is allied to both worlds, the spiritual world and the earthly world. He understands our suffering. Anybody that was beat like he was beaten on the cross, like he was crowned with thorns, drugged from judgment hall to judgment hall, ridiculed, made fun of, put down, bullied in a way of speaking, but all for the glory of what will follow. And by his visitation, our spirit is preserved. He came to save us. Let us so remember God as daily to approach him by way of duty. Let's approach the Lord with the same manner in which he came to save us. Ask him. Speak to him directly. Ask this question: what can I do to serve you, Lord, while I'm in this suffering state? That's a little bit of a different approach, isn't it? But that's what God wants from us. When you're feeling something, come to him. He was a human being on the face of this earth, and he experienced exactly what you're experiencing right now. He suffered for you. He understands human suffering way beyond any pain that we might experience. He's even gone through the gateway of death for you. So what's the benefit of suffering? It's because we know that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. It's because we understand that through our suffering, it will be over one day. And when it's over, we'll spend time with the Lord, never to suffer again, never to experience pain again. So we're going through it so that we can have someone ask us, how can you take this? How can you go through this? Why don't you fight them back? It's because the Lord will get glory out of how I treat this suffering that I'm going through right now, how I treat this loss, how I treat this disappointment. He will get glory out of that. That's why he suffered. That's why he had that indignation of the cross all over him. That's why the scripture tells us, in a few minutes I'll read it to you, that he stood on that cross, he took that pain in spite of the shame, in spite of the ridicule, he did it to save us. So perfection comes through suffering. We don't see it that way. That would be the godly way to look at it, but human beings don't see that. But look what it says that in Hebrews 2 and 10. For it was fitting for him, for whom are all things, and through whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory, to perfect the author of their salvation through sufferings. The author of their salvation. To bring him into perfection through suffering. And in fact, he brought many with him, as he's bringing you and I today. The word that he speaks of, this author of their salvation, he speaks of one who goes before to open the way, kind of in a military term. It includes the note of risk and sacrifice. And a sacrifice must be made in order for one to gain glory. In the Old Testament narrative, it has a parallel to the Joseph story. You know the story of Joseph. His own family betrayed him. His own family sold him into slavery. That's a prototype of Christ. It was his own people that betrayed him. His own people that chose him to die on the cross over Barabbas. Give us Barabbas. Give us Barabbas. Jesus suffered through all of that embarrassment, all of that shame, all of that putting down this Messiah. We too can take a little bit of suffering, friends. Not that we want to, but we do it because of the righteous character that it builds in us. Jesus himself got great benefit from his own sufferings. Joseph went through what he went through, but he sums it up for us. Even though his brothers had sold him into slavery and denied him, Joseph went on to become the most important man in a land that provided food for the whole world at that time. Look what he says in Genesis chapter 50 and verse 20. Joseph looks at his brothers and he says to them, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish the saving of many lives." We too can look the enemy in the face and say to them, "You intended to harm me with this, but God has turned it to good," because he's going to bring people to him through the fact that I am willing to go through the gateway of developing a righteous character for his sake. On earth, we're looking for glory, friends. Not glory, the earthly kind, but for heavenly glory. We're on a journey here. We're transgressing through so that we can get to where he is. So we must suffer some. We must meet with some difficulties. In his remarkable representative ministry, Jesus had to know the discipline that was mentioned in Hebrews chapter 10, enough to boggle the mind of anyone to think about the suffering, being made perfect through suffering. How can you say that? Well, we've had some taste of it. We get sick and we have pain, we have surgery, we have aches, and then we come through it all and feel so much better on the other side. Well, Jesus certainly had that experience, and so the Son of God could be made perfect is incredibly humbling to think that he had to go through so much. We have to humble ourselves and go through some stuff on this earth, friends. So don't think that because you're going through some kind of suffering right now, that that's the worst thing that can happen. No, you're going through it because Jesus is building a righteous character in you. He's giving you right perspective on life. He understands what you're going through. He's here. He wants you to speak to him as you're going through your troubles. He's standing and waiting to hear from you. And it says that we can be made perfect through suffering. That's what he's speaking to. So how the Son of God could be made perfect through such incredible humbling that took place, it means that we have a fully sympathetic Savior, one that understands life and death, able to help those who are being tempted, the scripture says. An example to us in the hour of testing, but also a unique person indeed, seen supremely in the cross of Calvary. You know, I don't care what we go through, we haven't been on the cross yet. It's central to the letter and to the whole of all Christendom today that we understand why he suffered. He suffered so that we could be free. That doesn't mean free on this side, but one day free. What's our learning outcome here? The value of suffering is that our suffering builds a righteous character. God wants his character to be seen through the sufferings of his people. The author of Hebrews says we are to look to Jesus not only as our Savior, but also as our example, as we suffer and endure the sufferings of this earth. Look with me at chapter 12 and verse 3 of Hebrews. Here's what he says in verse 3, verse 2 and 3, as a matter of fact. He says this, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of faith, who for the joy set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who has endured such hostility by sinners against himself, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. He wants us to think about how Jesus has managed his sufferings so that we don't give up on life, so that we don't do anything that would disgrace our Savior. To assume the place of honor God has for you in his kingdom, we'll have to always require enduring something. We're going to have to go through something to receive what he has for us. This is God's process of helping Christ's followers to become sanctified. He wants you to live a holy life. Look at chapter 12 again of Hebrews, and I'll end with this. Look at verse 11 through 13 of Hebrews chapter 12. He says, all discipline for the moment seems not to be joyful, but sorrowful. Yet to those who have been trained by it, afterwards it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness. Therefore, strengthen the hands that are weak and the knees that are feeble, and make straight paths for your feet, so that the limb which is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather be healed. He goes on to say just a little bit more. Look at verse 14. Pursue peace with all men, and the sanctification, there's our word, without which no one will see the Lord. See to it that no one comes short of the grace of God, that no root of bitterness stringing up causes trouble, and by it many defile, that there be no immoral or godless person like Esau, who sold his own birthright for a single meal. For you know that even afterwards, when he desired to inherit the blessings, he was rejected, for he found no place for repentance, though he sought for it with tears. Friends, we can cry after we've been through suffering, because we're going to come to that place where we're going to say, Lord, I'm sorry. The scripture told us a few moments ago, every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that he is indeed Lord of Lords and King of Kings. So this suffering that we're going through is momentary, and it's to create in us a righteous character so we can represent who our Savior is. We can become the prototype of Christ on this earth in the face of our enemies and in the face of our relatives and our friends and our loved ones. For our children, we can show them that suffering is not the end of it, but glory is to follow. But friends, you can only do that if you have this relationship with Jesus Christ. You can't be like Esau, who will give up anything just to have peace in the moment. You have to be able to stand firm. That righteous character needs to come out in your everyday lifestyle. We're going to suffer some, but ultimately we get in. And I thank God for that. And friends, today you can have the same benefit, but you have to know the Lord. You could come to him now, simply by remembering what the scripture says. It says that if we confess with our mouth that Jesus Christ died on the cross and believe in our hearts that God has raised him from the grave, then we too shall be saved. Friends, that's how you get saved. You speak to the Lord. You pray a prayer like this. Lord Jesus, I am a sinner, lost, looking for a Savior. I accept the reality that you died on Calvary's cross for me. I believe in my heart that God has raised you from the grave, and there you are in heaven right now. So I can go through this suffering on earth, Lord, because look what God did for you. He brought you to glory. Lord, you're going to give me a crown one day. You're going to give us a place of glory with you if we're just willing to accept you. Friends, would you accept Jesus today? God bless you, friends. God bless you.
I surrender all to you, my blessed Savior. I surrender all.
I surrender all to you. Everything I give to you, withholding nothing, withholding nothing. I surrender all to you.
I surrender all to Withholding nothing.
Withholding nothing.
Withholding.